Welcome to another episode of The World by 2030. Really exciting show today about the future of artificial intelligence, thinking machines, cognitive computing, and generally the interface between humans and machines. Lots of debates have happened recently about if artificial intelligence, AI, is good or bad, or positive or negative or dangerous. And a lot of conversation is cooking, and people are thinking about this in a really wide frame about preventing it, about moving forward, about a gold rush, about an arms race, all of those things. So today we're going to talk about what it means, whether AI will shake out to be good for us or bad for us or both. And we'll talk about the important questions. So let's start right here. This is my colleague Anton Musgrave. And we're going to speak about this topic in depth, and we'll take your questions later. And as usual, we have a debate and discussions, taking your input from the chat. So, Anton, AI, good or bad, ugly, pretty, beautiful?
Wow. Good. I think that's such a difficult question, but I think it's all of those all in the same moment. And the challenge for us really is to understand the context in which this debate is happening right now. Think back to the internet in 1989, 1990. We were asking exactly the same questions. Today, 30 years later, we're at the start line of its impact on the world. And artificial intelligence is exactly that. It's a baby that's just been born. Maybe it's not even completely born yet. And so the question is, are we prejudging this too early? I mean, do you really make an assessment on the lifetime earnings of an executive the day they're born? It would be crazy, right?
Well, you know, Socrates asked the questions about when writing was invented. Right? He said that people writing would lose contact with reality because they could write it down and use it again later.
Yes.
And when the internet appeared first in the 70s, people were worrying about that becoming the same overwhelming and also kind of distracting technology. So artificial intelligence, in my view, is kind of like the invention of the printing press. You know, setting us into a whole different future. And when the printing press was invented, the church said, we can't have this because the Bible can't be printed. It has to be copied by hand and only authorized people can read it right, or talk about it.
Yep.
And that changed absolutely everything. So with AI now, we have this debate about how quickly it can become superhuman, right? And allow us also to become superhuman. And there are lots of worries about artificial intelligence going out of control.
Yeah.
And so what's your take on this control issue?
I think it's interesting. I think the fear and the concern is correct. And that stems from the realization that we live today in an exponential world. We've exited the linear world. And so we're realizing that everything, whether it's AI or other shifts, are now facing this period of absolute exponential change, adoption, impact, etc. And in the few short months of GPT, we've seen huge impact, way more than we originally anticipated. And so that's propelling, I think, this concern and this fear, and it's not entirely misplaced.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's draw in a definition of AI. Demis Hassabis is the CEO of DeepMind, now owned by Google, of course. Like everything in AI. Demis said the other day that AI is about data and information turned into knowledge. And then generative AI, he commented the other day and said it's basically data and information turned into content, right, which is kind of knowledge. And that definition is both enlightening as well as frightening, because enlightening in the sense that machines are developing knowledge. Basic, you know, binary knowledge, and machines can develop content now. But there's the old saying, I think it's from Malawi, where people are saying, knowledge without wisdom is like water in the sand. And I think it's so true when we look at artificial intelligence, is that we have a lot of knowledge that's binary and simple computer-like understanding of the real world that is turned into answers, and which are also then binary.
Yeah.
So the thing I'm most worried about in this definition is that as computers become knowledgeable and then they start telling stories and doing content and videos and images and fake stuff, right, they will start telling a narrative.
Yeah.
And when they tell the narrative, does the narrative then become something that we read everywhere?
Yeah.
And if it's so good, will we see movies made with AI and news anchors that are AI and, of course, humanoid robots? And what happens at that point when the story of society is being told by machines?
Correct.
Will that story be transparent? Will it be full of hallucinations? Mm. Will it be full of lies? Will it be corruptive? And some people are saying, I think I would agree with that, is that as long as we don't know what is real or not, we may end up in a world that's completely synthetic. So I don't know if I'm talking to you or if it's a embodiment in a hologram of you that is run by, you know, ChatGPT-12.
Good. Let me assure you and the audience, I am really me. And if I pinch, I'm going to scream.
Oh, yes, you are.
This is real.
Good.
But again, let's just take a step back and address the fundamental of the concern. The concern is, will the narrative change? Because the machine has created its own words. But where does it get those new words from? From existing words, right? So we need to remember that artificial intelligence will deliver to us answers based on what it's been trained. Again, like a child. So we teach a child language. It starts with mama, then papa, and so we teach a child words, and then eventually the child can have a conversation. And hopefully, if we've not taught it too many swear words or words that are really bad, that child won't use those words. So the question is, how do we ensure that the artificial intelligence is selecting its answer from a database of good words with good values that are not meant to harm people? So how do we train a knowledge set for AI to learn from in a world that's polarized, in a world where some of the social media platforms harbor hate speech, etc.? So let's look at how we train and teach this thing, which notionally at least is within our control. Maybe we've lost that control already.
Well, you know, we have some precedent here in social media. And social media is essentially an AI system already. So the AI is telling us what we're going to see. There's no humans orchestrating your Facebook feed or your Twitter feed. It's AI doing that.
Yeah.
So what has happened is that AI is looking at very simple patterns and says, okay, if Anton talks about, you know, these things happening and it's kind of alarmist or whatever, it gets lots of clicks. So that is the first thing that we see. And so the result is social media presents us 6 to 8 times as many bad things as good things, because it's about selling advertising. And so if we take that as a blueprint, we can say, well, what would happen if we have AI telling stories and AI doing all that things in our lives? Yeah. We would end up with 1,000 times the problems of social media. Right? So that is a real concern, I think.
I think that's a very valid point. And that takes us back to another question, is how are we measuring success of society, of individuals, of businesses in this world? What are we rewarding? What kind of behaviors are we rewarding? And let's examine that and then ask the impact on the future of artificial intelligence. So I think we have a lot to think about and answer for in this journey of artificial intelligence, Gerd. And we mustn't blame it all on AI. Let's look at the picture in totality and say, yes, it can be incredibly powerful. I mean, think about the advances in medical research, in cancer research, expedited exponentially because of the impact and value of processing vast amounts of data can bring. Mm-hmm. The negative also applies. And so for me, the answer is not binary. It's not either or, it's and. And the question is, the outcome, I think, will depend to a large extent on how we manage it, how we think about it. And that'll take us into another episode where we have a conversation around the regulatory framework, which is a topic entirely on its own.
Well, I think one of the realizations is that AI can probably solve many practical things for us. The main thing that has been happening in the last couple of months is this rapid increase of productivity. So, for example, if I'm writing something, if I'm researching, if I'm trying to figure out a business problem, now Salesforce, for example, has this AI that can go through entire contacts and check back with them and see who's ready for a deal. You know, that is kind of, you know, routine stuff, right? Yeah. So basically what's going to happen is that AI will help us to be 5 or 6 or 10 times as efficient in many of those routine jobs. And that's primarily a good thing.
Right? Absolutely.
But the side effect of that is, for example, like, okay, so my company is going to hire 90% less people, right? Because I'm 10x efficient, right? And those are all like the effects that we have to look at.
I mean, that's exactly, I think, what we need to imagine. You know, the fourth industrial revolution, robots, AI, you've mentioned all the words, is about that. Unless the fifth industrial revolution is about rehumanizing humans, I think we're in trouble. What does that mean? It means capitalize, harness the benefits of productivity increases and gains. Absolutely. But then what do we do with the people? How do we introduce the real value of humans into the business equation so that there's a layer of value that a machine, no matter how smart, can never ever deliver? Think about the last time someone really cared for you and helped you and actually left you with a much better customer experience, right? So yes, it can automate the contacts in Salesforce, but it cannot give you that moment of joy, of elation as a human when you conclude a transaction. And then how do we monetize? How do we recognize that impact and that value? Mm-hmm. Huge question for us to think about in life generally, not only in business.
Well, I think there's a general issue, of course, about trustworthiness.
Yep.
And trustworthy with humans, trust isn't digital, you know. Trustworthiness means I believe what you say because I know who you are and what you stand for. And the same goes for brands or companies. So I trust maybe Apple a little bit more than I would trust Google or whatever it is. But I have trustworthiness. So for machines and algorithms and AI, trust and truth doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Because it is not the machine that decides what is true. It's the algorithm.
Correct.
So I have 90 cases of this, 60 cases of that, 10 cases of that. So, you know, answer is clear. Right?
Yes.
And even if those 90 cases are lies and BS, you know, then it's still true because it's just 90 times as much. And so the problem is, I think that, and this is where it gets interesting when we think about people being worried about artificial intelligence, is that we have this momentum that could basically create huge fake scenarios and wrong narratives that would enable us or drive us to think differently. And for example, it wouldn't be the machine starting the war, it would be us, because we saw all this information that was bad about our adversary, and we say, okay, that's all true, and now we have to throw a bomb, right?
Just to But humans further. Tolerated that wrong data input in the first place.
Yes.
So how do we create that level of trust? How do we create that level of accuracy, if you like? And then, of course, how do we as humans develop an ability to think critically with common sense, which we all know is not that common. But how do we develop the human mind to sense when something is patently wrong? Because we don't teach that in educational systems. We don't teach that in school. We reward people for remembering facts, which is crazy in a world of smart machines that we live in today. So these things are intertwined, they're interwoven, they're absolutely inseparable. We can't answer the one question without going down all the other big questions.
Well, maybe we can wrap up the episode on this thought of that I always like to use, you know, it could be heaven or it could be hell.
Yes.
I think it can very well bring us to kind of Star Trek society, you know, Nirvana type of positive future. We may be able in 10 years to only work 4 hours a day, 4 days a week for the same money.
Yeah.
Because the money is in the system, right? Mm-hmm. But if we do it wrong, we end up with fake narratives, fake worlds, synthetic people, rigged elections, loss of democracy, the story goes on. So to have the maximum benefit we can have from AI requires careful handling, policy, standards, regulations, social contracts. And currently, we're looking at this curve and we're saying, like you mentioned earlier, the economic drive, you know, to create an economy that is potentially, I think Stuart Russell said, $10.5 quadrillion fueled by AI. You know, if that's the goal and we don't care about anything else, then we're just going to go there and it will probably just be a big derailment. You know? So this is something we really have to be careful about. It's what is the final goal of using this?
Absolutely. And again, we need to take steps today that ensures that the destination we arrive at as a species is one of choice and not chance.
So a good wrap-up for the episode would be to say, you know, we have to define the destination. What do we want, not how we get there. First, to define the goal. And what is the goal of AI, which is to create a better society or more money, you know, or more power in the sense of military AI as well. So that is really what we're talking about. I think the answer to the question, is AI good or bad? You know, it could be both, and it depends on what the goal is. So.
I hate that I might sound like an economist, but it depends is the real answer.
Well, there's a great joke about AI and economists. You heard that one,
yes.
Right? So the joke is that ChatGPT is like an economist, always having an opinion, seldom right.
That's right. And if you don't like that one, I have another one.
Okay, I'll tell that later. Anyway, this wraps up the episode, and I hope you enjoyed it. And we may have dished up more questions than we did with the answers. But anyway, we're going to go into the chat now and get your questions live in real time. Please participate, send us your messages, send complaints, send videos, call in. As much as you like, and we look forward to our discussion.